So, good afternoon. It's nearly to 12 o'clock. So, welcome back to the class on tribology. So, before starting with the rest part of our module 3 related to idealized full journal bearing, I just wanted to discuss one case study related to your internals. Okay. So, for your internals, the portion is like second module full and until the half portion of your module 3, you won't be having the idealized full bearing part. So before that, what all we have covered related to the journal bearing, so all those aspects will be there. So it is like 1.5 module what you will be having for your second internals, second module full, and the third module excluding idealized full journal bearing, you have the remaining part. And coming to the case study part, so I have assigned this case study already in the Google Classroom as part of your assignment, I think 2 weeks before when I was not there to take the class. Okay, so this part will be your case study question. So here basically it is a case study given to analyze the failure in a journal bearing. In this thing, we are taking a case of turbo generator journal bearing. So you will get the question based on this particular case study. So please kindly go through it. I'll just brief you out in brief what does this paper actually mean about. Okay, so this is a purely a failure in a power plant, right? So what happens, why it happened, and how the failure was analyzed. So this is the basic thing which has been dealt in this paper. So the abstract will give you the full information. So we are studying a case study when there is a power plant blackout. So when there is a power plant blackout, so the turbo generator has stopped immediately due to some major issue. So this issue was mainly about the lubrication pumps, which was associated with the, so every time you will be having the lubrication pumps associated with the type of journal bearing. So here it is turbo generator journal bearing. So the lubrication pumps associated with this turbo generator journal bearing was not turned on. As a result, there was a blackout in the power plant, right? So due to this, what happened mainly is for a moment, the amount of oil supply was not been there. And hence, what happened, a major drawback came into picture, right? So due to this damage, it was observed that there was a drastic increase in the temperature and the vibrations which was there in the turbo generator system showed that there was a severe damage. The two symptoms to say that there was a damage is one is the increase in the temperature and the severe vibrations which was observed in the turbo generator that showed an indicative that there was a severe damage. So to do the analysis, what they did is they made the turbo generator stop. So after making the turbo generator stop, the bearings were disassembled. So after disassembling, the major damages which were happened were detected. Okay, so they it seemed like one of the generator bearings was damaged. Okay, so what happened there basically is a white metal layer of the sleeve was totally melted and the journal surface of that particular bearing was damaged, right? And along with that, we have an inlet to make the oil drop in between the journal and the bearing. So the oil supply channel was also being blocked. So these were the damages which came across when a lubrication pump was not turned on when the turbo generator was running. So this related in this type of damages. So later the people analyzed what how the bearing got failure and the total analysis of it is being taken care in this case study. Okay, so this is about the main paper and brief out about the entire case study. So based on this, you can go through the all the subsections. But still, I will brief out some other parts to you all so that it will be helpful for you all to do the study. And when it is a thermal power plant associated with any kind of steam turbine, Always you will be having like six journal bearings associated to the turbine rotors, and you will be having two journal bearings associated to the general motor, okay, in actual. So in that, you will be having the turbo generator lubricant system of the oil, which is supplied to two main pumps. So this will be driven by the AC electrical motor. Apart from that, due to some accidental issues, if it has to be safeguarded, you will be having two accidental pumps, the lubricant pumps, which gets on in order to safeguard the turbo generator. So that accidental pumps will be driven by the DC electric motor. Okay, so this is for the safety precautions, so that if the two main pump is not working, at least the accidental pump which is in need will be driven by the DC electric motor, so that the turbo generator will be safeguarded. So this happens actually. So with respect to that, the turbo generator lubricant system will be usually equipped with a spare oil tank, which is located in the housing of the turbo generator bearing. So wherever you go across with the bearing, any kind of turbo generator bearings or any kind of steam turbine bearings, you'll be having an housing. So there a separate oil tank will be located, so which will be connected to the accidental pump, which will be driven by the DC electric motor to safeguard the turbo generators. So this system will be there usually. And they always ensure that they have a sufficient amount of oil supply for the situations which can bear the required lubrication at least for a period of 15 to 20 minutes. So this is a buffer time within which any accidental thing could be overcome, and the regular main pumps will provide the required lubricant. So this is a safety precaution where you have a separate two pumps, accidental pumps, and a separate oil tank which has been housed in the turbo generator bearing, so that it can support the required lubrication for the turbo generator bearings to run smoothly without causing any damages to the surface of either bearing or the journal. So this system is always cultivated to see that there is no damage at all, or it will reduce the amount of accidental things. But even though having the safety precautions while running, they have forgotten to on the lubrication pump of the turbo generator. So this was a mistake which was being done, due to which heavy damage came across. So this is about the introduction part related to the safety precaution, how one will add on the accidental pump and an extra tank within the casing of the turbo generator bearing. Is it clear? Are you people there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this is about the brief introduction related to the case study of our turbo generator journal bearing. So I hope this will give you a clear idea. And later, the entire description of the turbo generator has been given. So which was the specification of the turbo generator, what they have used, what was the required nominal power, what was the speed with which it was being assigned to work. Okay, so what about the inlet, with what the steam was being injected, the steam pressure, everything, the rate of flow of the steam, all the configuration and specifications are given. So what did this turbine mainly consist of? It consisted of the shaft and the three cylinders. So even the cross section of the turbine has been assigned over here. So if you go through this entire paragraph, it will provide you the entire specification of the turbo generator, what they used actually, and for what long period of time it will be worked, what is the time of expertise, and how it is operated for what period of time. Everything has been given. So by this you will know the information or a description about the turbo generator specifically. So after this, the lubrication system in turbo generator is also being shown. So I told you that you will be having two main pumps, right, which will run continuously until the turbo generator is on, and apart from that you will be having two accidental pumps. So this will be driven by the DC and this will be driven by AC electric motors. So accidental DC pump will help you to support your smooth movement of the turbo generator without any damages. For that part, they use this type of these accidental pumps for the main overcoming of the damages. That schematic layout of how these pumps are assigned is being shown. I won't ask you to draw the sketches and all. Only thing, you mainly understand how the lubrication system is being imparted in our turbo generator. So you have to tell about the description of the turbo generator lubrication system, wherein it consists of two main pumps. One is the two main pumps driven by AC and accidental pump driven by DC. So this accidental pump will be driven by the DC motors. So one of the two main pumps is the backup one. So out of two main pumps, one will be running continuously and the other one will be the backup one. Okay, so during the operation, what happens? The main pump pressure of the oil for the bearing lubrication will be held at a pressure of 1.25 bar value. It also depends upon what is the pressure value at which the given oil is maintained. I told you very well, the oil or the lubricant what you are using should be able to develop the required pressure in it so that it can withstand the load which is coming across the contact area. So you have to see that out of two main valves, one will be kept as a backup and other one will be used for the film requirement between the journal and the bearing, and the pressure which has to be maintained should be nearly to 1.2 bar. Okay, so this is about the two main pumps. Then it comes about the accidental pumps. So in accidental pumps are the precautionary pumps what we are using to safeguard the turbo generator. So the accidental pumps what we use, which is driven by the DC electrical motor, will be maintained at a pressure of 0.7 bar only. We are using this for emergency purpose, where it can supply the required oil, yeah, lubricant film for a period of 15 to 20 minutes only. Okay, so this is about the two types of the main pumps and what is the pressure requirement for main pump and the accidental pump has been given. So rest about the scheme, it has been mentioned over here. So basically it consists of an oil tank. Okay, so this oil tank will be of two main pumps, which will be driven by the AC pump. And then you will be having further, you need to have a lubrication pipe system so that the required lubricant can be passed out in the form of a pipe system. And you should have the coolers. So oil itself will be the coolers. Sometimes if any cooler attachment is needed, you can use the coolers. And apart from that, we need two pumps for accidental purpose, which is driven by the DC electric motor. Apart from that, you need a reservoir drain for our lubricant, which is nothing but oil reservoir drain. You'll be having that. And I told you that we need extra tank to store the oil in the casing of the journal bearing. So you need accidental tanks to store the minimum amount of oil. And to control the pressure relay, you cannot blindly set the pressure for the main pump as 1.2 bar, or you cannot set the pressure for the accidental pump directly as 0.7 bar. You should be having some pressure relay in it, right? So you will be having a unit called pressure relay, which controls the pressure either to 1.2 bar or for 0.7 based on which tank you are selecting. So for main pump, it is 1.2 and for accidental one, it is of 0.7 bar. Then again, you'll be having a foam separator, a drain valve, okay, oil drain from the turbo generator. So to drain out the oil from the turbo generator, you need some draining valves. So you have the drain valves and the oil drain for the turbo generator. Apart from that, to feed the oil to the pump, you should be having the feeding pump, right? So you'll be having the feeding pump, the lubrication pump, and hydro couplings to get the required relative motion for the turbo generator lubrication system. So this is the entire schematic view of what all systems are needed in a turbo generator with respect to the lubrication part of it. Or else without lubrication system, it causes a major drawback due to heavy damages. So this we should be knowing how they adjusted with the main pumps and the accidental pumps to overcome the damages. So irrespective of so many precautions also, the turbo generator got damaged only due to negligence of non-oning of the lubricant pump. Okay, so this is about the main thing what you have to know So they have simulated this through a control scheme of lubrication system. So they have a software called Turbina. Okay, so this software helped them to simulate the same condition in which the material was damaged. So the schematic scheme of the turbo generator was analyzed using a particular software, Turbina. Okay, so and the same how they operated, the same way it was simulated over here. So when they did the simulation, the damage where they crept in, so those damages were being considered for the analysis part. Only they tested the simulation part of it with respect to the damage what they crept in actual when the machine was running. And later they have just given you an general bearing assembly schematic view and the actual picture of how does it look like and what all components it consists of. So entire thing has been described here. So this you can go through it carefully. Okay, so you'll come to know what were the components of this journal bearing assembly, how did it look like, and yeah, so same thing. This is a simple thing what you can read and understand. And lastly, they did the analysis part. Okay, so to do the analysis, they have done a very good analysis here. They just grabbed all the vibrations which came across, because in the abstract part I told you that the turbo machine bared a huge amount of vibrations. So due to this huge amount of vibrations, they could see an increase in the temperature, right? So the increase in the temperature and high vibrations led to show that the damage has occurred in the turbo generator. So these vibrations, what they observed, were being measured and it was being analyzed, right? You know the vibrations, right? In our mechanical engineering, mechanical vibrations. So we do analyze the vibrations through simple harmonic motion equations, so all those stuffs. So similarly here, they use the concept of 1x harmonic of vibrations and they analyzed how the vibrations increased. What was the amplitude of the vibration? At what peak value the resonance frequency was there? So all those they analyzed, and at that particular resonance frequency, what was the damage being caused? So all these type of simulations they have cross-checked. Apart from that, they have taken this snapshot where the major damage has crossed in the journal bearing, and they have described the reasons for this type of damage in depth. Actually, you can just kindly go through it. And apart from that, the journal bearing design we have studied in our module 3, they have just briefed out and sketch, rough sketch of it. So how was the rotation of this journal bearing while the damage and before the damage, an entire profile has been shown over here. And finally, they have concluded few things. Okay, so finally they told that after carrying out of many analysis, they concluded few things. One thing is, it is necessary to reconstruct the oil supply of the bearing 7 using design solution as shown in figure 9C. So they have provided a design solution in figure 9C. Okay, so this is a design solution what they have given. So if the design of the bearing has been done in this way, so they are telling that the problem which came across could be overcome. So please go through this in depth. You will come to know like what are the things they have been explaining. I'm just rubbing out in brief the entire case study so that at least it will be understandable by you. So second one is, the oil supply system should be installed on the side opposite to the existing. So figure 9B. So here, what they have told, that the oil supply system should be installed on the side opposite to the existing. Okay, so it has to be provided in the side. Usually we have at the top, right, the inlet valve of the oil. So it is shown that it would be provided, if the oil inlet is provided in the side, that will be better enough what they have concluding. And also they have told that the increased oil outflow on the side diametrically opposite to the oil inflow. So you have to increase the oil outflow on the side opposite to the oil inflow. 9C. See? So opposite to the inlet of the oil inflow, you should have an outlet for the oil outside going. So this is a design what they are planning. Instead of having from here, it has been shifted from here, this end to this end, as per their analysis. So they claim that this will allow a better journal cooling during the accidental delay. So this will really help when there is an accidental cases coming into picture. So it helps in cooling quickly the journal without causing much damage, because they observed that the temperature of the turbo generator was very high with high vibrations, which made for a larger damage. So to overcome that, they have planned the inlet and the outlet of the oil inlet in such a way that it helps in cooling the journal quickly and to reduce the damages which can happen in the accidents. So these were the conclusions what they have given out. So based on their suggestion, they say that the reconstruction of this type of power plant was done in April 2010. So this is what a small case study which deals about a turbo generator journal bearing which has been used for a steam turbine power plant, and how the damage came in due to small negligence of not owning the lubrication pump. So with that aspect, they observed high temperature and vibration, which was a result due to the damage of the bearing or the surface of the journal, right? So to overcome, they did many analysis and finally concluded few things. So this is about a small case study what you have to go through and keep it in mind. So based on this, the question will be asked in your internals. I won't be asking any schematic diagram of either the lubricant system here, right, or the assembling part of the entire journal bearing. So main thing, please focus on the concept. So based on that, the question will be asked, so you should be able to answer. So just go through the diagrams for your understanding, but no sketches will be asked with respect to your case study part of it. So this is about the case study. Any doubt in it? Hello, you people are there? Is
yes,
it clear
ma'am.
Enough? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So I will start with the rest part of the third module related to our hydrodynamic journal bearing. I'll just share just 2 minutes. I can see only 22 students. Why? What happened today? Where are the rest? No answer for this. Everyone are silent.
Put message.
Why? What happened?
No, tomorrow internals.
Tomorrow internals. I agree, but you should be studying on day-to-day basis. So then there will be no problem towards the end of either exam or internals. That shows you need to manage time properly for all. It's not like if one comes, the other thing has to be omitted. That is not a good sign of a professional student or a professional engineer. When you go out as an engineer outside to the industries, they assign you with n number of working load, and everything will be with the due date. You cannot say no to one when you have something else in hand. So you should know to manage all. So that is very important in life. So try to cultivate that as early as possible. It will be better for you people. Fine. So back to the class on tribology. So if you remember, in our last class, we were dealing something related to mechanism of pressure development in oil film. So we dealt, it is a very long back, in between we had many holidays also. So just to brush out, we were dealing with how the pressure development takes place and how the mechanism we have to use depending upon the requirement to develop the pressure. Because if the pressure is developed, then only you can able to withstand the load acting on it. So we studied like four cases. So we studied like case one, case two, case three, and case four. So all the four cases we dealt upon related to the pressure development. And we dealt about the formation of a continuous film of lubricant as required stage by stage from trigger A to B, from B to C, from B to D. Initially, both will be in contact. So then lightly when it starts moving, so then little amount of clearance it achieves. So this helps the journal to move from one position to other. And finally, the minimum requirement of the clearance between the journal and the bearing will be achieved. So this part also we had dealt in the last class. Then we had started about the concept on idealized full journal bearing of hydrodynamic lubrication. So I had spoken with respect to the assumptions what you have to follow in the last class. So I had told you what you mean by idealized full journal bearing. Can anyone let me know what you mean by an idealized full journal bearing? It's not like always I only will be speaking. We had dealt with this in the last class. What do you mean by idealized full journal bearing? Hello. You should answer. In case of idealized full journal bearing, when you call that as a full journal bearing, I told you basically in a full journal bearing, the journal will rotate and the bearing head is fixed. Okay, so the journal keeps on rotating and the bearing head will be fixed. So in that condition, even though the bearing head is fixed, the journal is a fixed member because it is in contact with the bearing. And this is connected into a machine member which is revolving around the journal. So you'll be having a journal and the bearing, both will be connected at a particular point. So to the journal, you will be having a revolving member which is associated, and this makes the entire full journal bearing to rotate. So here, this is an extra part which will happen in case of full journal bearing. So here you will be having a bearing head which is fixed with respect to the journal bearing arrangement. So the journal itself will rotate and it will be having a supporting machine member. This will revolve with respect to the journal. So this is a typical case where we call that as a full journal bearing. Only the difference what we observe in case of full journal bearing is, so while analysis, the main difference observed is in full journal bearing, the slider bearing, the plain slider bearing is due to the difference in the shape of the oil film. So there'll be some changes in the oil film, how we used to get in case of regular journal bearing and how the nature of the oil film will be there in case of full idealized journal bearing. So based, before going into the depth, you need to know some assumptions. So this also I had explained you in the last thing. Okay, so what are the assumptions we usually follow is there is no flow in the direction perpendicular to the motion. So first assumption is there'll be no flow of the oil in the direction perpendicular to the motion. The second one is the flow of the fluid should be always considered as laminar. And then the fluid what you use should be incompressible. And next, what you have to understand is the slip should not occur between the lubricant and the bearing surface. So you assume that there is no slip which occurs between the lubricant and the bearing surface. And then what assumption used to follow is the viscosity of the lubricant what we use should remain constant enough. And then the shear stress what is being induced will be directly proportional to the rate of shear in the fluid. And the clearance what you get between the bearing surface will be very small, and that is enough to get the change in the pressure across the clearance. Since it is very small, the amount of change in pressure what you get could be neglected. And lastly, it is about the inertia forces. So the inertia forces developed will be so small that could be influenced on the development of the pressure Okay, so in case of any film, but that is a very small value which could be easily neglected. So two things which has to be neglected is the pressure development across the inertia forces, and the second one is the clearance between the bearing surface. Since it is small, the pressure which is developed across the clearing surface has to be reduced, because in between the journal and the bearing, the clearance will be very less. Even though you have some change in pressure, that amount of clearance has to be neglected. And second thing is the inertia forces which are developed will be of very small amount of pressure, so even that could be neglected. So these are the assumptions one has to follow. So after this, now we are coming back to our journal bearing, which is an idealized one. So here you can see that you will be having a journal, and this is our bearing. So this is the direction in which the load is acting, right? So this will be the radius of the journal, and the radius of the bearing will be the radius of the journal plus the clearance. So this value will be the clearance. So there will be change in the thickness of the clearance in between the journal and the bearing. So this is the eccentricity value E, and you can determine the eccentricity ratio also. So for the purpose of analysis, some namings are being done, so that we will be taking care. So this distance will be referred to as H. Okay, so it is 12:25. I have time still, so then we can start up. So basically, this schematic diagram will represent how the structure of an idealized full journal bearing looks like, right? So this full journal bearing has an exhaust clearance of value C. So this distance is the clearance value. Wherever you go, this distance will provide the clearance value in between the journal and the bearing. Somewhere it is very less, and somewhere it is the maximum, and somewhere it is almost normal. So this has a huge clearance value, exhausted clearance value C, as shown in the diagram. Apart from that, you have the radius of the journal, which is R. I told you this is the radius of the journal R, and radius of the bearing, which is R plus C. So then the journal is loaded by a vertical load. So this is a vertical load W, which has been loaded on the journal. Okay, and it has been told that the journal is rotating in the clockwise direction. It is not anti-clockwise, it is moving in the clockwise direction. So this is the initial movement of the journal in the clockwise direction. So this is what you have to understand. So when it is operated, possible the fluid film will be developed in between the loop journal and the bearing. So this is the thing. And later what happens is, if the journal moves in clockwise direction and if it is in the eccentric position, so what happens? Then the journal surface moves into an eccentricity position relative to the bearing. So when it reaches to the eccentricity position, so this is the center of the journal, and this is the center of the bearing, and this is the center of the journal. So when the journal moves to the eccentric position, it will be moving in relative to with respect to the bearing. So at that condition, what happens? If the journal is unwrapped, so now here it is in a normal regular condition. So when both the journal and the bearing is in eccentric, means both come across this position. So this distance is the eccentric value. So when the journal is shifted to the eccentric position, what happens at that condition? If you unwrap the journal, so then what happens? It will be just like in straight line. So when you unwrap the journal at the eccentric position, it will be in the form of a straight line. And the length of the straight line will be nothing but 2 pi r. In this condition, okay, the h, what we want to measure, will be the film thickness. So this film thickness you can measure anywhere with respect to the distance from which you want to measure. So if you want to measure over here, then the film thickness you have to measure from this point to this. So that will provide the value of h at this position. The minimum film thickness value that you know, which is h naught. So there you will be having the least film thickness value. So in other ranges, you will be having the nominal value of r. So if you go here, this will be the h naught value, which provides you the minimum film thickness. But if you measure in the other region, you might get a varied value of h, depending upon in which position the journal is. If the journal is in eccentric position, then this also will be shifted to this point. So I hope it will be having an uniform value of h in that case. Okay, so this is about the value of the h in film thickness, how we measure with respect to the distance x. So this is the thing what you have to understand. And later we will go for the finding out actual film thickness. So you know that the film thickness, if you just consider over here, so this is a value of O. From there, if you just draw an extended line, this touches the journal as well as the bearing. So this has been named as A and B. Okay, so from this, if you want to calculate what is H, so you can measure this as H is equal to AB, right? So you will write H is equal to AB. So after this, this AB can again be splitted into two parts. So you can tell H is equal to, so if you consider from the center, so this entire line, so we want to know the value of AB. So this value of AB, you can replace that as OA minus of OB. So OA minus OB will give you AB, right? So you can write it as OA minus of OB. It is not underscore, it is OA minus of OB. So now you have changed the value of H in terms of alphabets, which is OA minus OB. So later now we should see what is OA. So come back to the diagram here, right? So here now H is equal to OA minus OB. So now you should know the value of OA. So come back to the sketch over here. So OA is nothing but the radius of the bearing. So this entire value will be equal to the radius of the journal plus the clearance. So that is the total radius of the bearing. So in place of OA, right, you can write R plus C. So you can write here in place of OA as R plus C. So this minus OB will be retained as it is. So from here after, if you need to determine the film thickness, the equation what we will be using is H is equal to R plus C minus OB. So this is one of the main equation what one has to know. And hence we have named this as equation number one. So later, now we will consider the triangle O1, OK. So you please see O dash, O suffix 1, O and K. So we had the value of O where we had extended the line AB. So if you extend this line back, and you know this O, O1 is nothing but our eccentricity value. So you have this line already. So from here, you just drop a perpendicular line. So when you draw a perpendicular line, so you will get the triangle O, O1, K. Okay, so this angle will be referred to be as phi, and this angle will be referred to be as beta. So here we are considering the triangle O, O1, K. Okay, so you will write from the triangle O1, O, and K. Okay, so this part O to O1 is our eccentricity value, and this one is named as been S. So angle included in it has been mentioned as phi. So from this, as in trigonometric concept, now we have to determine the value of sine theta. In place of theta, you have phi. So you will write sine phi. And you know that sine phi is nothing but opposite by hypotenuse. So which is the opposite side over here? For this acute angle triangle, you have the angle here and this is a 90 degree. So obviously this is the opposite side. So in place of opposite, you can write it as O1K. So O1K divided by hypotenuse. So hypotenuse, this is a right angle triangle. So this side is our hypotenuse, which is nothing but O, O1. So you will write as O1 and O is our hypotenuse. But O1K stands for S and O1 and O, O1 will stand for E value. So sine phi will be equal to S upon E. So from this, you can conclude the value of S is equal to E times the sine phi. So now we have developed the second equation with respect to the eccentricity value. So one for the minimum oil thickness and one for the eccentricity, we have known the volume. So now after doing this, we have to go for the next triangle. So the next triangle here is O1BK. So which is the triangle O1BK? So this is O1, so this is B, and this is K. because what happens is you have O2, O1, and this we have analyzed already, O, O1, and G. And later, what we have to do is, so now you have to analyze the triangle O1, B, and K. So what you do is this, you have this line extended until K, and we have drawn a perpendicular line here already. So from this point, you will blindly join to the point over B. So when you join this line, you will get the required triangle O1, B, and K. So you will go for O1, B, and K triangle. Okay. From here, also you need to determine the sine angle. So here the included angle is referred to be as delta, not phi. So always you should see that which is the included angle. In first triangle, it was phi, and now it has been delta. So you will write here delta. Okay. So this O1B will refer to the radius of the journal. So if you go back to the diagram here, you can see wherever you draw this line, this is the radius of the journal. Okay, so the connectivity here, what you have joined, will provide the radius of the journal. So in place of O1 to B, you can write it as R. Right? So O1B is R, and again O1K is S value only. So from this, again you determine the sine delta value, which is nothing but opposite by hypotenuse. So opposite side is nothing but O1K. Right, so you will write it as O1K, and hypotenuse is nothing but O1B, so you will write the name as O1B, and then in place of these letters you should write its main values. So O1K is nothing but our S, and O1B is nothing but the value of R. So after you substitute from this, you can again get one more equation for S, which is nothing but R into sine delta. So now we have two equations related to S. So comparing equation 2 and 3. So if you go back, you have here S is equal to E sine phi, and you have S is equal to R sine delta. So both you will equate, right? So in that case, what happens? E sine phi will be equal to R sine delta. We have E sine phi, and here we have R sine delta. So if you equate the equation number 2 and 3, you can write in this way. So this is the fourth equation or fourth conclusion what we are mentioning. How the values of eccentricity and the radius of the journal vary with respect to sine angle, phi, and delta. We are showing a comparison. So this will be our equation number 4. After that, we have to go for one more triangle, which is O1BH. So where it is located? O1BH. And H. So we covered this first triangle, and then we covered the second triangle here, and the last one is you have to cover one more triangle O1BH. So you have the center here O. So from O, if you just extend this line where it meets to the journal end, so you will get the other name. So you can name that as H. So O1BH, now we are referring as a triangle. Okay, so when you compare this O1BH, let it be zoomed here only it will be clear. Okay, O1BH you have, right? So this is, so you have here two angles. If you consider OBH, you will be having two triangles here where you have two included angle. Okay, this angle will show an value of beta, and this angle will show you an value of delta. Okay, so this is the thing what you have to understand. So after knowing, you can, if you club both together, that will provide you the value of phi, because here it is shown this entire angle is phi. So phi will be equal to delta plus beta. So based on the diagram, if you go back here, you can see that OBH, so this angle is phi, and H, O, and if you give any name, so this angle will be theta. But we are referring this angle B, O, 1, H. So this angle is 5. So, but it is a combination of two included angles here. One is delta, another one is beta. So due to the comparison of both the angles with the sketch, you can tell that phi is equal to beta plus delta. So from this equation, if you need the value of beta, then you can simplify it. So then the angle beta will be equal to phi minus of delta. So this will be the equation. So we are basically getting the values for almost all the terminologies of an hydrodynamic journal bearing, like for eccentricity, R value, and the minimum thickness, oil film thickness, which is H value, and again the supporting bushing angle, what we give related to beta. So we are dealing. Okay, so we got an equation for beta is equal to phi minus delta. Then we have to go for one more triangle which has been left out. Yeah, the same thing, O1BH. So this we are dealing, right? O1BH. So from this triangle O1BH, again determine the value of sine delta. So sine theta is nothing but opposite by hypotenuse. In place of theta, you have delta. So if you compare to the triangle here, O1BH. So you have to write opposite by hypotenuse. So which is your opposite side here? It is nothing but BH. So which is your BH? So this is your BH. So you write opposite value and hypotenuse. So this is the right angle triangle. So hypotenuse will be this. So BO1. So you will write it as BO1. So BO1 is nothing but the radius of the journal. O1B is a radius. If you go to the sketch here, O1B will provide the radius of the journal. So obviously it will be R. And BH gives the value for M. So it has been shown here already, BH. So this distance is nothing but the value of M. So you will write in place of BH as M. So from this equation, sine delta is equal to M upon R. Okay. So if you need the value, so then what you have to do is M is equal to R times of sine delta. So you'll write here M is equal to R times of sine delta. But here it has been mentioned as sine beta because they are considering the value of the combination of phi is equal to beta plus delta. So that we will go into depth later. So now don't worry, you for this situation, you can also write as M is equal to R times of sine delta also. So related to beta configuration will come back or else you'll get confused. At this stage, you can even write M is equal to R times of sine delta. So after this, we have to consider one more triangle which is left out, which is triangle BOH. Small one. We did now BO1H. So now we are dealing with BOH. So this is a triangle what we have to deal now. So BOH, where did it go? Yeah. So in this triangle BOH, again, the included angle for BOH is 5. So this 5 is again equal to delta plus beta. So later we see about that. For time being, the included angle is 5 for the triangle BOH. Okay, so based on that, we were here. In this triangle BOH, sine phi will be equal to opposite by hypotenuse. So opposite is BH and hypotenuse is OB. So we'll write. So in place of this, then you need to know the value of OB. So which is our OB? From here to here. If this is from O1 to B, you know that is a value of R. But now you need to know the value from O to B. So to know the value from O to B, you have to do the slight simplification, right? So this equation we have already, sine phi is equal to BH upon OB, right? So here OB will be equal to, okay? So OB will be equal to BH upon sine phi. So you can write BH upon sine phi, but BH is nothing but our value M. So this BH is nothing but our value M, and hence it has been written as M upon sine phi. But what is M? M is equal to R sine delta. Here also kindly write it as delta. Later we can change related to the beta terminology. So M will be equal to R sine delta upon sine phi. So this is the equation what it gets reduced. So here what happens is you have now OB is equal to R sine beta upon sine R sine delta upon sine phi. So once you have written this, then you have to come back to the next slide. Here you have a change here. Why? Because previously we have proved that phi is equal to beta plus delta in this equation. right? So this is a total angle phi. So we have two included angles. One is delta and beta. So phi is equal to delta plus beta. So when you have phi is equal to delta plus beta, you can find out the value of either beta or delta, which is one and the same, right? So now you will change the value of it accordingly. So in place of r sine delta, if you have kept r sine delta, so then this will be of beta minus of phi. So you have to write it as beta minus of phi. But here they have taken it as r sine beta, including these two, taking the difference between phi and delta. And hence here for them it is as r sine beta. So if that is the case beta, then in place of beta, you have to write it as phi minus of delta. If you have taken as delta here as r sine delta, so in place of delta, you have to write it as phi minus of beta. Since they need the terminology value of beta, so they have replaced the delta by the term phi minus delta. Hope you understood here. Here you have delta, right? So in place of delta, if you need delta, it should be phi minus of beta. But since if they have taken beta over here, in place of beta, it has to be taken phi minus of delta. And hence the equation here, in place of sine beta, they have written as phi minus of delta. And the numerology denominator part will be the same, sine phi. So you will write OB is equal to R sine phi minus delta upon sine phi. So this octal ending here, if you see this part, it is nothing but in the form of sine of A minus B. So from trigonometry, you know what is sine A minus, what is sine of A minus B. You have to put bracket over here basically. Sine of A minus B is nothing but sine A cos B minus cos A sine B. And also you know that cos square theta plus sine square theta is equal to 1. But here we are replacing theta by the value of delta. So you know cos square delta plus sine square delta is equal to 1. So from this you can take cos square delta is equal to root of 1. It should be minus here, right? Because sine square theta comes to this side. So it will be 1 minus sine square theta. So this is a value for cos delta what you have to write. Root of 1 minus sine square delta. So now this is the equation. So these are the prerequisite documents which are essential for you to support this equation. So when you look into this diagram, in the equation, you can see that it is in the form of sine of A minus B. So here you can change in the form of sine A cos B minus cos A sine B. So same thing has been written over here. So R into sine of theta minus delta is written as sine phi cos theta minus cos phi sine theta. Similar to this formula. So after you write the denominator as usual, which is sine phi. So after this, R upon sine theta is taken towards your left, right? R upon sine theta you will write. And then open the bracket. Here you are writing sine phi, right? After sine phi, what is cos delta here? Cos delta is root of 1 minus sine square delta. The same thing has been mentioned here. So it is 1 minus e square upon r square into sine square delta. Because you had that equation there. Sine delta is s upon r. Okay, so this is one equation what you have, and you have s is equal to e into sine theta. So based on these two relations, if we simplify, it finally comes to e upon r. Okay, in terms of root of 1 minus sine square theta. So here it will be 1 minus of e square upon r square, because it is associated with the eccentricity and the radius factor in case of journal bearing. And hence we add on e square upon r square into sine square. And again minus of the same value what you have over here, which is cos phi into e by r gets added into sine phi. So this is now the equation changes with respect to cos delta equation changes what we considered. So after that, what you do is you have r by sine theta, then you have sine phi here. If you remove this r square from the root outside, it will be just r. So denominator will not be here. Sine phi by r is taken outside. So remaining part of r square, if you take the LCM, it will be r square minus e square upon r square. So that r square is taken outside the root, it will be r. So only the numerator is left out, which is root of r square minus e square into sine square theta. So this is over. And again, minus of e cos theta, you will write it. Because sine theta, we have taken it common here already. So the sine theta is taken common, r square is taken common. So left out part you will write within the bracket. So this sin phi and sin phi gets cancelled. R and R get cancelled. So OB will be equal to root of R square minus E square sin square theta naught sin square phi minus of E cos phi. So this is the equation for OB what we get in case of idealized full journal bearing. So rest I will continue in the next class. Only I will just complete and ended up for the value of H. And later, since you have the eccentricity value here, it is always assumed to be very small when it is compared with respect to the radius of the journal, right? So what we assume that E square sine square phi is equal to zero. Since eccentricity value is very less, we assume that it is negligible. And hence, we take the assumption that e square into sine square phi will be equal to 0. And hence, the value of OB gets reduced to, since this is 0, you remove r square from the square root. So it will become just r. So r minus e of cos phi. So this will be the equation for OB. So in that, what you do is, you will substitute the value of OB in equation 1. We got the value for H in the very, very early case, right? So this is a equation 1 where we got the equation for oil film thickness, which is equal to R plus C minus of OB. So you'll write down this equation again and you substitute the value of OB in this equation 1. So when you substitute, it will be R plus C, the previous one what you had. Where is that? Yeah, this remains same, R plus C minus OB. So OB value you will change. In place of OB, you will write R minus E cos phi. Okay, so R minus E cos phi. After that, you can simplify it. So it is R plus C minus R, minus into minus, it becomes plus. You will write E cos phi. So you have 1 plus R and 1 minus R. It gets cancelled. And hence the value of H from here after will be equal to C plus E cos phi as it is shown in the next. So this R and R get cancelled. So H is equal to C plus E cos phi. Okay, so H is equal to C plus E cos phi. But in place of E, we are writing as NC. Why? Because N is the eccentricity ratio, right? So based on that, in place of E, you can write it as E is equal to N times of C, because eccentricity N is equal to, eccentricity ratio N is equal to E upon C. So if you need the value of E, you have to replace N into C. So in the previous equation, it was RR get cancelled. It was C plus E into cos phi. Now that is being changed into letter N. We are referring the eccentricity ratio here. So from here onwards, the value of H will be C plus N into C plus into cos phi. So this is the equation for the oil film thickness, okay, with respect to the modifications of the OB value. Without OB value, if you want the value of H, then this is a general one, R plus C minus OB. If you want the changes for the value of OB, then this is the equation. You can either use this equation if the eccentricity ratio is given in the problem. If the eccentricity ratio is not given, only the eccentricity value is given, then the value of H will be equal to C plus E cos phi. So based on the data given, you should be knowing which equation to be used. So remaining part, I will do it in the next class. I think two, three more slides are there. Since it is 12:50, I have to end now. Any doubts until here? Hello, you yeah, please go through each and every step of derivation. It is important. Later, after this derivation, design considerations, we have to solve the problem on full journal bearing. So each and every equations, terminologies, the concept of how the journal will move towards the right, yeah, left, everything, you should be very clear enough. Everyone write your name and USN in the chat room. I will start calling the attendance. Today is 4th. Please answer the attendance. Abdul Khalik Pasha, I think, is absent. Akhil KV. Akhil KV.
Mom, Akhil typed in the chat box.
Okay, he's present. Okay, fine. Anil Kumar.
Present.
Ankesh. Ankesh. Ankesh Aman is absent. Gautam Krishna.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Balaji VR.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Beldar Mohammed.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Chaitanya.
Present, ma'am.
Chetan Kumar.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Dheeraj.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Ishant. Ishant.
Ma'am, chat box.
Chat box, okay. I didn't see it. I have given him the attendance. Harshit.
Yes, ma'am.
Himanka. Himanka, you're
yes,
absent. You're present. Why you are absent irregularly?
Yes, ma'am.
Please don't be absent. Be regular.
Ma'am,
what happened?
Yes,
Kanishka. Kanishka is not there. Naga Murali Krishna. Naga Murali Krishna is absent. Kunal Raj.
Present, ma'am.
Dhanush. Mohammed Ayan.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Mohammed Junaid. Mohammed Junaid. Absent. Shri Prasad.
Yes, ma'am.
Niharika.
Present, ma'am.
Nihar Venkat Sai. Nihar. Absent. Nikhil R.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Neerab.
Yes, ma'am.
Prajwal.
Present, ma'am.
Rishabh Pandey.
Present, ma'am.
Rohan Kaglakar. Rohan. Absent. Roshan Yadav. Roshan. Suman Sagar. Sumant. Sagar Dutt Mathur.
Yes, ma'am.
Sagar GV.
Present, ma'am.
Sanjay Raghav. Sanjay Raghav, I think, is not there. Shobhit.
Present, ma'am.
Siddharth B.
Present, ma'am.
Siddharth Sridhar. Sridhar Siddharth. Absent. Subramanya. Subramanya. I think even he is absent. Tirumana Seti Rohan.
Yes, ma'am.
Ulas.
Present, ma'am.
Vidyan. Vidyan. Absent. Varun.
Present, ma'am.
Pavan. Pavan is absent. Danush.
I'm present, ma'am.
Okay. Dhyanesh. Dhyanesh Kumar absent. Gunasagar. Gunasagar absent. Meghanatha.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Rasik Baran. Rasik. Absent. Shiv Krishna. Shiv Krishna absent. Shreyasel. absent. Many absentees today. Why? Srinivasalu? Absent. Yogananda? Kiran? Kiran is also not there. Ranveer Singh Chauhan? Gautam Sai?
Present, ma'am.
Abdul Khaliq Pasha is not there.
Present, ma'am.
When I called you, where were you? The very beginning, the very first time I called you, that shows that you were not in the class. You have logged in only for the attendance purpose then. You were at the last, but initially first today I called your name only. There were no one to answer.
Network problem here, ma'am. I can't hear properly. Voice is breaking off, ma'am. That's why.
I can see the login time of you.
I have logged in. You can check, ma'am.
Yeah.
Long back I had logged in, ma'am.
Okay. So Abdul, okay.
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, Shiva Krishna present, ma'am, in network issue, ma'am. I want to talk.
One second, I'll come back to you. Shiv Pawan?
Present, ma'am.
Alok? Yeah, now tell me, what's your USN, Shiv Krishna?
406, ma'am, 18 MA 406.
Yeah, I have marked your attendance. Okay.
Ma'am. I have network issue, ma'am. Yeah.
Okay. Regular. You are irregular, actually. Attend the classes regularly.
No, ma'am.
No, it is only 14 classes what you have attended out of 24.
Okay, ma'am.
And for everyone, all the best, study well. I will be sharing all the PPT and the materials before today evening. Okay? So please be safe. Take care, study well. All the best for your internals for all the subjects. Take care and bye-bye.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Bye-bye. Thank you.